I'm Joe. And can everybody hear my voice clear? Loud and clear? A little flat. Oh, okay. This speaker doesn't work. Anybody happen to know how to use this thing? So you can see the screen? Okay. So let's get started. So today we're going to talk about some problems that you guys probably met when you were implementing the shell and the scheduler, and particularly the shell. So let's go to the specifications. So one problem is that some people who, is there any people who have already run the test script? So it's the fat exactly, right? It's the fat exactly. Yeah. So you're probably using exactly P. Are you using that? You're not expected to use that, because if you use exactly? So if you use exactly, you have to specify the full path name to the LS. So you will usually you will specify /bin/ls, and yeah, so it still records the error message. So it's kind of weird. Yeah, because I want to talk about another problem is that I will talk about environment variables later. So let me just start from another problem is that people say that when they create their prompt is actually misordered with the output of the shell. So what I mean is that have them send an email to notify you guys. So you actually can run the test, like, part. So I got two errors here. So if you look at the run test block, you can see run test block. You can see there is a couple of tips about how to run your program on the input we designed. So let's run those tests. So you output something like this. The problem somebody actually encountered is that their shell output will be mixed with the prompt. Okay, let's go ahead. Kind of white? Oh, okay. Some people actually have some outputs like this, but their problem is actually printed after the output of the shell program. them, so the output is like kind of like this. So. So a normal output is probably like this and some blah blah blah. So this is the output from the LS. Okay, it's the and then they will have their prompt at last. Some people have some such kind of problems because they actually use printf and instead of write to write the output from the shell. So does anybody know what why? Why it would happen if you use printf instead of write? I mean, I can show you what would happen if I use printf. Print from. So what would happen if I, so this is what I said, if you use printf instead of write to print the output or print the prompt, chances are that you will get output like this. So first of all, this is the output from username, so the input file is like username and then ls and shell. So first of all, you will get a output from username, and then you get the output from ls, and then the prompt that I printed out. So the problem is that printf has some buffer, so you will buffer the output so that your program will probably be a little bit more efficient if you just do a couple of writes. Because when you do a write, you're actually writing to a file, and you need to do file I/O, and that would probably be slower than just print out those things in batch. So let's do some experiments. I can show you how to do. I can test. I can show you how to measure the difference. First of all, I'm gonna test the time it takes to print out some strings. Output of this program will be redirected out. Oh. So this program simply print a couple of test strings. So we're gonna measure the time it takes to print to finish this program. So. Thank you. the time it takes to print out 3 million test strings using printf. Let's use write, okay? So first of all, it's write. And then probably take about 12 seconds, I think. About 12 seconds, 15 seconds. Okay. Yeah, it takes about 15 seconds. So this is the difference between printf and doing it right. But actually, if you look at the implementation of printf, it's actually called right. So they are basically doing the same thing, right? So they are actually doing the same thing, just write the strings to the output, but the time is different because if you use printf, there is a buffer mechanism so that everything which is supposed to print out to the output will be buffered in the buffer, in the memory. So let's say the buffer is something buffer, and it's kind of like an array in the memory. And every time you use a printf in a program, these strings will not be actually output. Instead, they will be moved, they will be copied to the buffer, and every time you are writing to the buffer instead of writing to the standard output. And at the end of the program, because if the buffer is full, or the program is going to terminate, the printf will use write output out. So that is why it is actually much more efficient than write, because it is doing the write in batch. So there is a similar stand output library in C++ and Java. In C++ it's called cout, and in Java it is named systems.in or something like that. Sysout, yeah. And so this actually at the end of the day they actually will call the system called write to write the output, but they will, most of this library function will do some buffer so that the output will be output to the standard out in batch instead of writing the output to standard out a couple of times. So there is a specifications in the project page saying that you should not use print, right? There is specification said that you should rewrite printf into write something. So this is the reason that you don't want it to buffer the output. But what do you think is the real reason for not buffering the output? Because usually when we implement a program, we use a couple of printf, but it still works. But why in this case it doesn't work? we don't want it to use point F, so we want to use right. Yeah. Yeah, LS maybe using right. So you mean yeah, this is a good reason, yeah, this is a good point. It's one of the reasons. And what else? So actually there's a couple of reasons for that, and let's take a look at the program, because when you are doing the shell project, you probably do a fork, something like that, fork a trial process, and then in that trial process you do exact, so just like we said before, so just do ls, something like that, and then in the parent process you do something else, you wait for that trial process to terminate before continue the shell. So if you use a lot of printf here in the shell, then after the ls, after the fork process, the trial process terminated, the output of the trial process will be output first, and then the output from the shell will be output after the output from the trial process. That is why you would get some disorder output, like first the command, the output from the commands, and something like that, and then the whoosh. So this is the problem about printf and versus right. And the next issue in here. There is a lot of people don't understand the pass, so I'll talk about a little bit about the pass. So really, the pass is only a convenience for most of the program. So why do you want to use a pass? The reason you want to use a pass is because you don't want to type the full name of your program. So if I type an ls, it's gonna do the, it actually will be translated to /bin/ls. So this is the reason you want to use a pass, because it's just give you some convenience, right? And if we go to see the path in the Linux environment, we can do something like this. The dollar size means to expand the path variable. Yeah. So you just print the path. So this is not easily see. So I will just, yeah, usually separated by the comma. And now we'll just replace them with the new one. So probably a good thing. So you can see here there's a couple of paths. And when you call ls, the shell is gonna search for each of the paths to look for the program ls. And if you ever find one, it will just execute the program. Like, so you can take a look at the path of the shell using which ls. So if you use which ls, it's gonna show you the full path of your program. Yeah, so this is actually in the implementation, which is actually just doing path search. It's going to the path specified here, and then it will search for each directory, search for this program, and if it did search one, it will just print out this /bin/ls. So you are supposed to do similar things in this program here. API is supposed to do similar things. So when the user specify two paths, you probably want to maintain an array of strings to hold these two, and then when you want to execute a program, go to search for that, and don't use exactvp actually. So let's take a look here. Let's talk about the difference. So for the exactv, you give the full path of the program to exactv, and then the argument to this program. But in exactvp, you actually give the file name, so you're free to specify ls or something like that. And if you did get an error, you will just be, if you did get an error in using ls, you will just say ls cannot find path instead of a full path of the ls. So in the memory, the environment is actually a part of the private memory space of a process. In the memory, it's stored like this. So first of all, it's the heap memory, and then a bunch of free space, and then the stack, and then argument, and then the environment. So environment is actually on top of the arguments, and arguments are on top of the stack. So actually, they are one part of the process. If you want to take a look at the environment, you can take a look here. So I will just list the process here. So this will show all the processes running by me. So let's pick some process. This is a couple of shells I'm running, and then this is the process ID. I'll go to look at the environment of those things. So first of all, this process ID 1 is 50, and then it has the environment. So this is the environment variable for this process. So it is stored on top of the argument. So if we want to take a better look, they are separated by a /0. So there's a bunch of things, and specifically you can look at the path. Yeah, the path is here, is one of the environment variables of a Linux process. And the home directory and the user directory. So these are part of the environment process. Part of the environment of process. And so the pictures of the next layout in the memory. Yeah, it's like this. So first of all, this is the heap. So the heap is put here, and then there is a couple of free space, and there is a stack, and after that there is the arguments, and then the environment in a typical Linux process. And the stack layout is like this. So first of all, it's argument argcount, and the argv, and a null to terminate number arguments, and then a couple of environments here. And if you want to use something like, if you can change the environment variables to change the behavior of the process. So let's say we change to some different language. So let's say we change it to something else. So apparently he has changed his language because I don't understand these things. So it's probably another language. So if you change to another language, it becomes another thing. Yeah. So this difference between the argument and the environment variables is in the way the environment variables is going to be inherited by the trial process. So you may have something like export. You may do something like export and something like language. This is basically saying that you want all the processes that you want all the trial processes to use the French. So whenever you execute a program, the language environment variables will be written to the private memory, private address space of gedit, the new process, and then gedit will just run in that language. Yeah, so it will run. Saying that the PID of this process is 26166, so I'm gonna go to this process. So I'm gonna show that. Is pretty much about the environment variables. So for the first part of our so actually they look pretty much the same, right? So they are laying out as on the stack like this. So first the arguments and the environment. But for arguments, it's actually for every processes, the arguments will be different. For every trial process, you give different arguments to them. So let's say we do something like ls and something. And then this guy will be the slash FDF slash DF will be the arguments for the trial process LS, but if you do something else like echo something, hello will be the argument of echo. But if you do this like this, the environment variables of the shell will be inherited by echo. Yeah, so echo and the shell will basically have the same environment variable, but they don't have the same arguments. So this is probably an advantage of using the environment variables instead of the arguments, because it is very useful when you do something like you want to start a graphical user interface, the GUID, and then you want to start some process. So let's say we actually choose the language to be something else, like French, and then you start a graphical process, because most of the process will be forked from the terminal, and the language of the terminal is French, so those processes will be run in French instead of some English or something like that. Yeah, so this is probably an advantage of using environment variables. And if you play some games, actually, if you know some, like Steam, if you really play some games, or you go to Windows, if you use Windows, there's some things that is pretty much similar to the environment variables. You can set like launch option equal something else, and then there will be the environment variables for Steam. So you can run it. So you can change the behavior of a process. In your function? Yeah, of course. One of the functions you can use is print environment. So you would just print all the environments. So it's all these environments. And if you want to use some system functions, I think it's to use get environment, which you will use in this project. In the Linux part, because when you use get environment, you can specify which environment variable you're going to use. So let's say when we use path, it will just get path. But this is a system call. It's not actually a user program. So we take a look at that here. So if you want to get an environment variable, just specify the name of the environment variable here, and then use this one. When you implement PWD, you probably won't use it to get the environment variable for home. So let's go back to our project. So the Linux, this project actually composed of three parts. The first part is basically the building commands. The second part is the environment variables path. And then the third part is the redirections. So the first part is basically the parsing. So we just parse the full commands into different strings, and then construct an argv. So basically, you would receive a command from the user in the shell. Let's say echo hello world. What you're gonna do is just to parse this string into different components. So first of all, you will use a tokenizer to tokenize this whole string into a couple of words. So probably it will be tokenized as echo hello world. And this will be actually argv to the exact. There is a system call. There's a library functions that actually execute the program. So this is a path to the file, the program, and then it needs a argv. So your job is just to parse the string into an array of strings, and then parse it to the exactly. So this is basically about parsing, and for the path, so yeah. So if we fix successfully parse this string into a couple of words, then we're done with the argv, and then we need to get parse. So the path you want. This is where the environment variables come into. So you basically by default you have a slash bin as a path. So whenever you execute a program like ls, you're gonna fly this program in the path, and if it exists, you concatenate the two into slash bin or slash ls, so that it becomes a full path that can be specified in exactv. So at last, you actually specify something like that. So first of all, slash bin slash ls, and then the argv. The argv is like an array of strings. The first one is echo, next one is hello, next one is world. Yes, and then basically you're doing that. Any questions so far? No, if you use exactly, you don't need to set in by right. Yeah, because the whole purpose of doing exactly is pretty much like let you search through all those paths that the user specify. If you just use exact VP, then it's just a lot, just very simple. Yeah. If you, I think you probably do something like exact key and then the program, and then set environment to. If the user call path, you set the environment to the path the user specify, and then you use exact VP to call the to the, call the program name, right? And you probably do that, but actually, yeah, you have to use exact VP because there's a test that tests whether you use exact VP or not. Yeah, and you actually have 10 points. So this is basically about exactly. So this is pretty much the part of the program, and then the another part of the program is filling commands. This is more simple. This is actually much easier. It's simpler, and the filling command is like, so you just do something like you just compare the after you pass the argv, you have some. Hello. And then you just compare the first one with the building command. If it does match, then you just call you just use the building command for the two arguments. This is pretty simple. And for the for the redirections. So the way it works is that thing is in the specifications it's that you have to close something and before you do an open. So the way it works is that if you close the standout file number. So this is actually a file descriptor maintained by each process. So every process has, let's say we have a process one, and then it actually maintains 0 with a file handle. 0 will be pointing to a file handle, and then 1 will point to another file handle, and 2 will be another one. So if you close standout file name and open up again, open up another file with the file handle, so let's say it's output. And it's probably, so actually, it is actually, you will actually replace the file handle here with the output you actually open. So that whenever a process print to the standard output, it is actually going to use something like write one, something else. So it's gonna be printed out to the output. Output? You mean output?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. I mean, in our project, it's actually out. It's output or out actually. So this actually is the file name I want to write here. Yeah. Yeah. Actually, if you just give a name of that file, it's gonna look for this. It will just create a file in the current directory. If you give it a full path, it will just create a file in the path it specified. So there is no environment variable here. You will not go to search for your path to look for this file. You're not gonna do that because this will be the file that the user specified. Yeah. it for this. So it means just the user would specify something like echo hello world and then output. And then you want to append extension to this output. So it would be this one, and then so standard output will be written to this file, and then standard error will be written to this file. And the user just specify the prefix of this. So this is basically about the directions, building commands, and programs. Go ahead.
Okay,
so
you want to refer to all the data to
Yeah. Or maybe I didn't explain it very clearly before it, right? So the reason is that the printf will do the buffering. And if you do a shell, in a shell, you actually fork a process, and then you will get two different shells, two different processes. So one is the parent process, which is the shell, and one is the trial process. And if you use printf, then printf is gonna buffer your output in the memory, and then those output will at last be printed out when the process terminates. So in a shell, the parent will do something like this fork equal to zero, then do something to the trial. So this is the trial process. And then the shell will usually wait for that. Wait for the trial process to terminate before it moves on. So here this is the parent. So when the trial process terminates, then the output will be printed out to the output file. And then because printf is doing some buffering, it will only print the output at the point when it has to. Exactly. About the first part of this? About the first part? Alright. So, let's move on. Oh yeah, I actually want to show you something interesting. Actually, when I was grading the test, there's something wrong with this, so let's take a look at this. So here you can see my GCC is actually version 4.7.3, and I'll run this guy's, when I run this guy's run test. Oh, he's actually failed. And afterwards, he came to me and said he's actually using the GCC here. Let's take a look at this. Yeah, there is another. You can see which version of GCC you're using. So let's take a look. So this one is the GCC I'm using, but he's actually using another one, which is GCC. So this one is actually 4.4.7. And when you use this one to run, it actually passes all the tests. So I can run it here. So let's fork. Yes. So when I prepare this user/user/ bin before my path, you're gonna search for GCC in this path. If you found it, you would just use it instead of searching the full path. So let's see. We'll run the test again. Let's see. Yeah, it passed on the test. Yeah, because we, so if you have any question about, if you have any question about grades, please remember to email me, and maybe I usually respond very quickly, but these 2 days I have some quiz or something, and then I didn't really respond very quickly. Yeah. Sorry about that. Yeah, this is the basically everything about the about the Linux part, and for the XV6 part, so first of all, remember to replace your make file, replace CPUs in your make file. So let's take a look at the example. So I mean, I can show you the example. Simply run make humu mods. Oh, I actually modified it already. So actually, you can see here in your make file. Here, so it's saying basically saying if CPU's task is not defined, it's default to 1. But actually, in your make file, it actually default to 2. So I changed it to 1. So let's see how it works if it is 2. It is the first one is CPU 0 and then the next one is CPU 1. And if you want to change, instead of doing a make file, you want to change it when you're doing humu nux, you can do something like CPU equal to 1. It's basically, it's pretty much like setting the environment variables for this process. So when you do, let's say we have 4. So it actually starting 4 CPUs. So you just specify the environment you want, environment variable you want. Some small stuff about XV6. In this part, actually all you need to, let's take a look at some files. So, because in the specifications we were asked to implement the set priority and then get key info. So for get key info, you are given a struct, a pointer to a struct pstat, which resides in the memory space of the user program instead of the kernel, and then the kernel will fill in the information in this pstat star. Let's take a look at this header file. Yeah, the header file is like this. So it's actually kind of like a process dump. So you actually record all those things in the new PID, XTX and LTX. And so if you remember, in the first project, we just did something like that. We just count the number of processes that is alive. So it's pretty much like going through the whole process table and just record those things like ITX and LTX and the priority of each process. So in order to bookkeep those things like the number of ticks each process accumulated at a higher priority and those in the lower priority, you probably want to modify your header file so that you can bookkeep those things for each of the process. So this struct, you probably want to modify this, and then proxy is the place you want to add something here. Yeah, so you're supposed to change the behavior of your scheduler so that this process is scheduled according to policy specifying here. So the way it works is that whenever a timely interrupt happens, the user program will be interrupted, and kernel it will be switched to the scheduler. And the scheduler, so it actually happens when this statement returns. When the switch returns, that means whether the system call happens or the timer interrupt take place. So it will switch from the process to the CPU scheduler, and then switch the kernel virtual memory back, and then going back to this follow. This follow here, going back here. So whenever a timer interrupt happens, it will go through this process, and then pick another one to run. So your job is just to look at those processes that is in high priority and run them. It's kind of like that. So you can either choose to increase the ticks when you pick that process to run, or you can increase the ticks after the process is picked to run. The user specifying its own memory space. How does the kernel? Oh, you can declare it. You need to declare it in. Where is it? Yeah, you pretty much declare it in the kernel so that it can. You can use this one to fill in all the information. Yeah, it's being used or not? No, in unused state. So it's pretty much like the P1 P table. Yeah. Zombie, yeah, because it is in use, right? The process table, the slot is in use. So it's, maybe it's a zombie process, but it's still living, living dead. You mean just put it in the kernel or something?
Yeah.
If you put it, you have to include something. You have to include it. Yeah, I mean, you have to include the file if you want to use it. Let's say this file is named. Yeah. Otherwise, how can you know? How can you know? Yeah, you need, because when we use it, we pretty much use this header to test your program. So what we're gonna test is to just dump all those things out and check whether it's right or not. So if you use a different, let's say you actually name it in a different name, then we cannot do this. Okay? We cannot really. I think you can do both, actually. Is there any difference? Yeah, of course you have that. But you can also choose to copy paste this stuff into the somewhere in the kernel. Yeah. But you just don't change it. So just don't change it to some other name, something, so that we can test it normally. Any other problem? Any other questions about XC's part? If you have any question about the grades, just let me see. Just email me. And that's it for today.
Would you like the content?
What's that?
Would you like the content such that you can upload the session today, the content session today to the website?
Oh, you mean the recorder?
Yeah.
Yeah, I actually recorded it.